have this structure, include cases where you take P brains with P not equal to 3, so decoupling limits of 2 brains, 4 brains, and so on, fundamental strengths, and also many of the Einstein-Maxwell-Villeton systems that people use as bottom-up ADS-CMT models also have an underlying generalized conformal structure. And so we'll have a sort of argument why the behavior of chaos is the same in these models as it is in the ADS. So I get to a certain age group where I'm referring to my own papers from 10 years ago and recycling certain formulae from them. So a lot of the analysis in this talk really comes from a long paper which was written with my then student, Mark Hennetscheider, who is now a neuroscientist. So he's running, he does a spring break in neuroscience. He's literally using some similar techniques from neuroscience. So this was about developing a holographic dictionary for non-conformal brains, by which I really mean in these cases the P brains, fundamental strengths, and coupling limits. So this is a paper from about almost 10 years ago now. And then there was a paper which sort of built on this by adding, essentially adding gauge fields and seeing how it applies to maybe SCMP models. And this is a paper from 2011 with Glazer and Zero. And these were also our students, Elena and Elena Smart. They're not twins, actually. They were, Elena is the older sister and Elena is 9 months younger. Nine and a half months younger. Okay, so almost twins. Okay, so this is, the generalization. And the more recent paper I'm talking about is a paper from the summer, the same title as this talk. And there's also some work in progress, which I'll mention as I go on. Okay, so this is a sort of fairly self-contained talk, where I'm not assuming that you've been following the literature on what the SYK model is. And it's, like I said on Monday, my talk there was a biased introduction for ADS-CMT. It was emphasizing certain aspects. So this is a biased description of SYK. I would sort of advise you, if you want a less biased description, to actually go and look at papers of Anderson at Stanford and others, and Rosenhaus and Gross and so on. But I'm picking up the essential features for what we need. So the Sacher-Hayek model. So we've got fermions in one dimension, we've got n fermions, and we will ultimately be interested in the case if we take n to be large. So we have a standard kinetic term, and then we have a quartic interaction. Now, of course, Sacher and Ye, being kinetic matter physicists, what they wrote down originally was not a Lagrangian, but a Hamiltonian. And the Hamiltonian is just, trivial, the genre transform of the Hamiltonian. We notice that the Hamiltonian is just this quartic something. It seems a triviality, but you'll see why in a moment why I wrote it down this way.
Sorry, this model has some similarities with the Ising model.
Yes.
Because it seems very close.
That's right.
Perfect.
Yes. So in some sense it's pretty much one of the simplest things you can do. Just to say why Sacher and Ye wrote it down, so this was in the early 90s. So the next ingredient they added in is the couplings, these quartic couplings are randomly taken from a Gaussian distribution. So what they had in mind was high temperature superconductors, a toy model for high temperature superconductors, and they wanted to correlate one set of superconductivity to some behavior of, some random behavior, interactions with impurities and so on. And so that was why they introduced the random coupling. Of course, for condensed matter physicists, this is a much more reasonable thing to do anyway, because random kind of behavior is something which you might see in condensed matter systems. But they had in mind high temperature superconductors. It didn't do what they wanted it to do, really, but then they found some nice features and they exported it. Okay, so the lambda is taken from a Gaussian distribution, it has zero mean, and then the width can be characterized in terms of a dimension called parameter. And bearing in mind that we will be interested in doing a large n expansion, it turns out to be convenient to characterize the width with an appropriate factor of n to the 3 halves. That's what comes up in just the top counting. So the thing that really defines this model is going to be this dimensionful parameter, which is the width of the Gaussian distribution.
Marika, may I ask you that? There was a paper by Witten stating how one can get around using these random couplings, but it's not many people seem to have followed up on that. Do you understand? My understanding was that.
I will come to that. Actually. I will come to it. So it's a good point. It's one I was going to make a little later. So initially people were sort of saying that the random behavior was something that is completely essential. It is not essential, and we'll come on to see that this is not really the interesting feature. Now, variants of this model, so here we've got quartic fermion interactions. There are variants of this model with Q interacting fermions, which you can write down. And in particular, Margaret Sanner and Stanford and their paper wrote down such constructions. And then more sophisticated constructions start with the paper of Whittle. Which I should say, David, you know, for your amusement, David Gross was visiting Southampton, the Costas and David Gross and I had Whittle's model on the blackboard a day before he came out, which was kind of annoying because, you know, give us another week, we could have written it up. But actually, you know, Whittle scooped us. We were sort of kind of happy that we almost got Whittle out. Okay, so you can write down the variants of this model. Laura Sanner and Stanford, as I said, explore variants of this where they sort of quartic coupling. We have happily involving an even number of fermions. Basically, the physics is the same, except for the case where it's a mass. So, you know, the qualitative features are the same. You take coupling between six fermions, eight fermions, 10 fermions. The difference is when you have a mass term, and, you know, there, you know, one loses many of the interesting features of the theory. Now, to solve this theory, what do you do? So actually what happens, again, we almost go off and have almost a lecture of its own on this. What really happens is the following. So you, essentially the first step you do is you just integrate out these couplings. You integrate over the Gaussian distribution, right? And when you integrate over the Gaussian distribution, this produces for you a bilocal coupling to the quartic power. So a bilocal coupling between two fermions to the quartic power. And it's at that state point where the randomness is really just gone away, because you just replace this with just an eight fermion bilocal coupling. Okay, so really the interesting physics comes from that. Now, the second thing that happens is that once you do that, you have a path integral which is really localizes, and it localizes using this bilocal field, which is essentially the two-point function averaged over the fermions. Okay. So there's a saddle point approximation of the path integral. That's the basic feature. And so this is a statement that, no, you really don't need the randomness. What you really needed here was a path integral which really localized on the interaction. Okay, it was really that feature. So in contrast to matrix models, which come out of string theory, supersymmetric matrix models, those typically don't tend to localize on the interaction term. They actually, it's the kinetic terms which are dominating, and the interaction terms are small. Here we've really found a non-trivial saddle point where, you know, it's really the interaction which is dominating. And so you can solve things in terms of this bilocal field, which is effectively classical in the large limit. And so this is, you know, the theory is effectively solved in terms of this, the behavior of this bilocal field. Now, people often say, and Sacha Vernier and Yeh claim that there was an emergent conformal symmetry in the infrared. So in other words, if you looked at this bilocal field for large separations in time, then they said that there seemed to be a conformal symmetry. In fact, I put it in quotes in case that I don't, you know, it's not really a true conformal symmetry. So what they mean by this is that if you look at large values of the separation in time relative to the dimensional scale set by the only dimensional scale we had in the problem, which is the width of the Gaussian distribution, they mean that our classical field behaves basically as a scales with the power. And so for them, for condensed matter physicists, apologies if there's anyone in the room who considers themselves a condensed matter physicist, if you discover a scaling behavior and correlation function, you say there's a conformal symmetry. But that is, you know, that is true when you have conformal symmetry, but it is not sufficient for there to be a conformal symmetry. Okay. And so in particular in this case, we can see it's not true. The power that appears here, the effect of dimension, is related to the number of fermions which are interacting. So Sacher and Yeh were considering a case where we have four fermion interactions. Again, not the sun and sound push this to any arbitrary even number of fermions, and the dimension just behaves as one over that number. Now, there's another fun trick that you can play. It's not really particularly playing a role in this talk, but because one is of low dimensionality, one can kind of play games where one does a reparameterization of time and then effectively obtain through that trick the finite temperature two-point functions. So the media can obtain from this two-point function for free the finite temperature behavior.
This two-point function has some holes.
Yes.
It corresponds to some kind of pattern in the book. But the geometry is fixed, I guess.
Yes. Yeah. I'm not entirely sure of the interpretation in this particular case of that. I've seen it discussed in higher dimensional versions, but I didn't just cause any points.
Because in this case.
Yeah. Well, I think it's hard to interpret in the low dimensional case because its reparametrization is just coming from reparametrization in a sense. Giving that interpretation is hard. But I may be wrong. Okay, now, so this in itself would have been, a nice feature we have recognized quantum theorists, but the feature which is really interesting in this model is that the entropy is of order n, and remember n is large at zero temperature. Now, for those of you who have been following what Sachdev has been saying over the last 10 years or so, one thing that's bothered Sachdev as a condensed matter physicist is the idea of having systems which have a large degeneracy of states at zero temperature. So he can live with this when there's supersymmetry, because then there's an understanding why you get a large degeneracy of states. But it's something that bothers him a great deal in the context of something that's not supersymmetric, because it seems to contradict a version of the third law of thermodynamics, right? Some people would express that as the fact that the entropy should go to zero at zero at zero temperature. Of course, you can express the third law in other ways, which is that you need an infinite number of steps to reach zero temperature. Okay, but certainly something that has bothered him with what we're doing in string theory. And it's also part of the landscape discussion. So the question of if we find non-supersymmetric black holes at zero temperature, are they really physical, or should they be in the swamp plan? Can you actually have a non-supersymmetric theory that has a larger degeneracy of states at zero temperature? So there's a whole background of actually thinking about this problem. And this is a model which really has a non-trivial entropy at the order n at zero temperature. And in addition to that, it scales the partition function, the entropy scale with temperature, the inverse of beta, which is the temperature at finite temperature. So in particular, if you write down the partition function, you write it down in terms of the ground state energy, a zero temperature entropy, and then you've got a specific heat, and all of these quantities, E naught, S naught, C scale with N, which is not surprising. It is solved that these two scale with N, but the fact that we have a non-trivial entropy even at zero temperature is surprising. And then we have a linear growth of a partition function at temperature, at low temperature. Now, why is the latter interesting? Well, again, remember why Sachdev's original motivations was to try and explain high temperature superconductors. And one of the defining features of high temperature superconductors is that just above the superconductor transition, one has this so-called strange metal phase in which transport properties scale with temperature instead of scaling as they would usually do with temperature squared. So finding a model where things would scale with temperature, that in itself is kind of interesting. And so Sachdev, already some years ago, highlighted SYK as capturing interesting features of black holes. So the first one is the entropy being order n at zero temperature, and the second is the fact that a specific heat and transport properties, well, transport is ill-defined because of low dimensionality, but the specific heat scales, this behavior scales with temperature. Okay, now why are people not taking very seriously? Well, we've got a one-dimensional model here. One field theory dimension, just time, and we've got no global symmetry of the model. So why I made such a big deal on Monday about global symmetry being related to compact manifold is because this doesn't seem to have the features to capture our favorite rising inertia type near horizon behavior of black holes. We don't have an ABS. If you had an ABS 2 cross S2, you would expect to have an SO3 symmetry in field theory, and you don't have the symmetry. So we could believe that this has a two-dimensional gravity dual, but we don't seem to have any information here about the other part of the black hole. Okay, and that's one reason why people didn't take this tremendously seriously when he sort of said that this had something to do with black holes. Okay, so why did people start taking it seriously? Well, this really comes from chaos. So Monsona and Stanford and Schenker have discussed that chaotic behavior can be explored by looking at appropriately time-ordered four-point functions. And so in particular, in this particular model, a natural four-point function to consider would be a four-point function for mean fermions. In fact, the rule, as I'll tell you later, is you can consider a four-point function of any operator that doesn't require a thermal expectation value, any typical operator. But the cheapest thing we can think of writing down in this model is just a model is just a four-point function involving fermions. And for various reasons, again, just for simplicity, I will do an averaging. I will take two of them to be identical, you know, that are identical in pairs, and then I will sum over ij and average, and that's why we get this factor of 1 over n squared. So that's a normalization factor. Now, if you work out what is happening in this four-point function, before I talk about the time ordering, so there's clearly a trivial leading order contribution, which is just the disconnected contribution which involves a two-point function between this pair and the two-point function of this pair. Okay? And that's what's shown here. So in this four-point function, there's a trivial disconnected contribution, which is just the product of two two-point functions. And then there is a non-trivial connected contribution, which just by large n counting will be subleading in n, so it will come equipped with a factor of 1 over n. And then it will be a function in general of all four positions in time. But actually, if you go through the analysis, and this would be quite a long discussion to go through it, it turns out that the interesting part of f is indeed expressible in terms of a function of a single cross ratio of these values. So again, we seem to have some emergent symmetry here, because something which could a priori have depended on all four positions actually turns out to just depend on one single cross ratio. Now, the required out-of-time correlator is the one that people consider for chaos, is the one which was discussed in Modestan, Schenken, and Stanford. One way to do it is to use a separation of the fermions by a quarter of the fermion cycle. And so you have two fermions separated in real time, and then you just separate them along the thermal cycle in real time. And now, Montana Schenken and Stanford taught us to compute this correlator. And this said you can actually compute brute force in this model, and you can extract the required out of time correlator. And what you find is that this function here grows in time, so it depends on t1 minus t2, it only depends on the separation of t1 and t2. And that contribution grows exponentially in time with the Lyapunov exponent, which is 2 pi times beta. Now, Modestan, Schenken, and Stanford hypothesized that that is the largest Lyapunov exponent that one can have. This is a maximal growth, the maximal chaos that one can actually have. So chaos is characterized by exponential growth with respect to with the Lyapunov exponent, and their claim is that this is the largest that you can have. And I should say, for a model in quantum field theory, this is indeed very large. So you take your favorite matrix model in string theory, which people like Masamori and Nader and others have done, and you compute the Lyapunov exponent working perturbatively, and you get, if I start reinstating sort of appropriate h-bar factors, you get something which is really, massively smaller than this value. So that, the onset of chaos is far smaller in those cases. There are some cases where some examples and theories which were explored by Eric Perlmutter and others, where one seems to get a faster growth than this, so one seems to violate this bound, and their interpretation is that the theories that they were exploring are actually theories which are sick. So they were thinking about high-spin type theories. They got a violation of this bound, and the interpretation is that the theories which are sick. So why is this cool? Well, we've got an explicit calculation in theory of without gravity, in which we've got a Lyapunov exponent, which is the same Lyapunov exponent that we get with black holes. And so this is a suggestion that this theory has something to do with black hole physics. And it's really, in a sense, this observation that came from Bikatayev, which triggered the sort of interest in this model. And then Montana and Stanford, in a sense, worked out more details than Bikatayev had actually done to explore what was going on. Now, there are finite terms in the four-point function as well. So, this is the term which is growing exponentially in time, but there are also finite terms in the four-point function. And these contain information about operators in the composite operators in the OPE. And they contain information essentially about the spectrum of the theory. And these operators form a tower of states with approximately integer spacing. Actually, the last time I gave this talk in Cambridge, they were pronouncing and said, what do you mean by approximately an integer? It's not an integer. It's not. I mean that the spacings are sort of, they're non-integer, they're actually rational, but they're very close to the very close in value to integers. So they're something like, you know, 5/6 and you know, 1 1/7/8 or something. But the point is that there's a whole tower of states. And now, this is an indication that, you know, this is a simple indication that you don't expect the theory to be well described by just Einstein gravity. Because if you have a quantum field theory which has a holographic dual, one of the defining features is that there should be a large gap in the spectrum between the gravity and light modes and heavier string modes. There should be a significant gap in the spectrum. You shouldn't have a spectrum with even spacing. You should have a very big gap. You should have a few light modes, which would correspond to Einstein gravity plus some scalar fields and matter fields of low mass. And then you'll have some high dimension operators which correspond to string modes. Here we've got a rather even space spectrum, and that's an indication that you wouldn't expect the theory to have an Einstein gravity dual. And, you know, there are other ways of saying this argument. This is discussed nicely in a number of different papers. But, you know, this is basically an argument that we don't really expect S by K to be captured by just Einstein gravity. But then that's kind of a puzzle, because we just said that S by K has this nice feature that it seems to have an onset of chaos which agrees with black holes in Einstein gravity. Okay, so why is it that it has this agreement if we don't think it actually has anything to do with Einstein gravity? And I'll come back to this issue as we come to the end.
Are you guys, I got confused about one that must be crucial, which is, you emphasize that this Lyapunov exponent is completely different in this model than in standard Lyapunov models.
Yeah.
But in the other cases, don't we also model black holes in
Okay, so that's a good point. So of course, let's take something like the theory describing D0 brains, right? So maximally supersymmetric Yang Mills in zero space dimensions, one prime dimension. That's the kind of thing that Samori and Marenko are simulating. So the point is there are two parameters in the theory, right? There's a Yang Mills coupling and there's M. And so they're really simulating at small quantum. Effectively, that's what they're looking at on the lattice. They're not really probing the full non-perturbative regime with their simulations. They're kind of matching. They're always starting, they are, even though it's a lattice simulation, they're still effectively simulating around small top coupling. And so in particular, even before we discuss chaos, even if you look at things like, you know, the entropy, and you know, thermodynamic quantities, this will not agree with what you get from gravity, which is a large top limit. You know, you can see some interpolation, so they get further than we can get with just pad examples, but they're kind of just getting up the slope, okay? And so in those models, they cannot really access the form, you know, the regime in which we have really black hole behavior. So even before we talk about chaos, they don't have, you know, entropy and things which are behaving and matching the black hole entropy that we see in holographic models.
Is that the same thing as the fact that they need these streaming corrections?
They don't. You can turn the argument the other way around and say we've got the supergravity description, and if we could do streaming corrections, we could come down the slope the other way, and we could kind of approach them.
Which is a sort of match of the attempt in some.
They do. We can discuss how well they do. I mean, they certainly they do this to some degree, but they can't really meet in the middle. I think that's a fair statement, which Ms. Samori would have no problem with saying. Yeah, so that is the difference. That's the real conceptual difference compared to this model, that really they're working around the perturbative limit.
Okay,
so what has become apparent, I mean, it's not particularly relevant for this talk, but what has become apparent is that the randomness in this model was a complete red herring, because your first step was you integrated it out. The real feature was that you actually localize your particle on an interacting term. And so all these melonic versions, melonic theories, they basically have very, very similar behavior. So it's really that feature which is essential. So there are many variants of this SYK model in which one has rather similar behavior. This is not in itself particularly special. Okay, so now I'm going to, so having dismissed the fact that it's likely to have Einstein gravity dual, I'm going to explore more the symmetry structure. So the logic on Monday was that we had to understand the defining board identities of the theory to understand how we might realize it holographically. So I'm going to kind of take a sidestep and explore a bit the symmetries of the theory. And in particular, I'm going to claim that this theory is really not conformal in the infrared, it's got something else going on. Okay. Now, so in a conformally invariant theory, if we look at scalar operators, the two-point functions behave, they have the scalar behavior in the vacuum. And the only condition we have here, the only non-trivial behavior which is allowed by scaling symmetry, is an overall normalization factor where the normalization comes from, is expressed in terms of dimensionless couplings, so the couplings which define the marginal directions, and any parameters of theory, which in this case is just n, the number of degrees of freedom, and delta is the dimension of delta. Now, you might be used to just saying that this is absolutely trivial, it can just be absorbed into the definition of the operator, which indeed it can, but it is of course important to remember that whilst when we work in conformal field theory, we tend to normalize the operator two-point function, so this is one. When we work holographically in supergravity, the normalization that comes out is actually a non-trivial function here, and it actually comes from the prefactor of the supergravity action. So whilst you can absorb it into the coupling, it's actually quite into the operator definition, it's actually somewhat unnatural to do so. Because everything that comes from supergravity comes equipped with the same overall power of the end. So in general, whilst you might want to set this at one, what I'm saying to you is actually in practice, in holography, we often have a normalization that this is not true. Okay. So this is true. If you have conformal symmetry, then this is true. Conversely, however, just because you have found in some limit, in particular in some limit of large separation, that the two-point function has a scaling law, does not necessarily imply that there is an underlying conformal invariance. Right? This is necessary, but it is not sufficient. Okay, so the relevance in this talk is a particular way in which you can get this kind of behavior without having conformal symmetry. And this is generalized conformal structure. So this might a priori sound a very contrived situation, but actually, as I will explain to you, this is something which happens in a number of string theory examples and in the SYK model itself. So we have a theory in which the conformal invariance of the theory would be conformal invariant, except that we have a source for a scalar operator of a particular dimension. And more generally, actually, we can have multiple sources for multiple scalar operators. One can contrive examples where one has more than one operator involved, but let's just warm up with one operator. Okay, and this is true at the quantum level. Okay, so the non-trivial statement is that at the quantum level, the only way in which conformal invariance is broken is by this allowing the source for the scalar operator, so a dimensionally running coupling for a scalar operator. Now, as I said, it's quite easy to write down in classical theory a theory which has this kind of behavior. What is non-trivial is that the structure will be respected by quantum corrections in theory. Okay, now, if we have true conformal symmetry, as we said the other day, we would have that the trace of the stress tensor is zero up to possible conformal anomalies. And we would have that the stress tensor is conserved. In this theory, we have that the trace of the stress tensor is controlled by the operator that is running, the dimensionally running coupling. This is exactly the identity that I wrote down the other day. And we have that the stress tensor is in general not conserved if the source depends on position. There are many examples actually when it's interested in the source, it's static dependent on position, so actually the stress tensor is still conserved, so that kind of drops out, but the trace of the stress tensor is no longer zero. So as I said, this sounds a very contrived situation, but actually it can happen. Now this theory is clearly not conformally invariant because the trace of the stress tensor is non-zero. But it is symmetric just formally under scaling transformations, provided you also transform the coupling. So, you know, the coupling is something that's given to you as a react here, right? The coupling is something which is there, it's a parameter of the theory, and so it's not something which you're allowed to play symmetry games on. But formally, at least, if you do allow, if you do do symmetric transformations, it's coupling and accompanying transformations of the scaling transformations of the metric, then the theory is clearly invariant. And so this is not a symmetry, because again, this transformation is not allowed, this function is given to you, right? It's given to you in the mix. So you're not allowed to do this as a symmetry, but the existence of the invariants, if you did do the symmetry, gives you a so-called generalized conformal structure. Now, I didn't create this name, I should have had a citation here. It was really Anton Jawicki and others who came up with this name for it. It's not the most catchy name. But what it means is really, this generalized conformal structure is really captured by this relation. And this relation holds in the presence of sources, so you can functionally differentiate it many times. So if you functionally differentiate it with respect to metric, you get the two-point function of the stress tensor is related to the two-point function between the stress tensor and this operator, and so on and so forth. You can just keep going. So the generalized conformal structure is captured by water identities, which imply an infinite set of relations for correlation functions. So you've got something weaker than conformal symmetry, but you still have an infinite set of relations for the correlation functions. And it's useful to work with, so this source that we've switched on, so this is something I've just given you, it's useful to form something which is dimensionless. So you multiply it by an appropriate power of the distance scale, and then you get something which is dimensionless. So this here is dimensionless. So in this theory, if you have a general scale operator with a particular scaling dimension delta, then the two-point function, it has, because of the scaling dimension, it has this 1 over x to the delta, and then the normalization can depend on the parameters in the theory such as n, but also this dimensionless coupling. But the dimensionless coupling that we just defined over here, of course itself depends on the position scale. And any function of the dimensionless quantities is consistent with generalized conformal structures. So this is what we discussed in the 2008 paper. Now, this function may be analytic, it may be a Lorentz series, it may have logarithmic terms in it, so that depends on the case at hand. It depends on what other sort of structure you want to impose in your theory. But typically what can happen is that if you look at the behavior of this function in the extreme ultraviolet or extreme UE, so at small distances or large distances, typically what happens is that this function is dominated by a single term. So you've got a Taylor or Lorentz series, and actually that gets dominated by a single term. So over here, this becomes x to the beta, and you see it looks like you've got a scaling behavior for your two-point function. But actually you haven't, because really, you know, this thing here is actually a series, typically a series, and you just went to, you know, short distances or large distances, and you just saw one term out of the series. So again, this is a sort of statement of just because you find a two-point function in an infrared limit in the scaling law does not mean necessarily that you have conformal symmetry. This is a concrete case where it might just be generalized conformal structure. Now, again, you might be saying this is all very contrived, but actually there are some theories which you know and maybe like, the Bach, which actually do this. So the first is the massively supersymmetric Yang-Mills theories. So this is exactly the same Lagrangian as I wrote down the other day in four dimensions, except in four dimensions it's conformal. And outside four dimensions it's no longer conformal. Well, you know it's no longer conformal because, you know, the gauge fields outside four dimensions just classically are conformal. But this theory, you know, just if you look at the bosonic terms, you can play the game that I played, and you look at the behavior of the coupling, you can just do Weyl transformations of the coupling, you can convince yourself, indeed, that this has generalized conformal structure in all dimensions. And the operator which is conjugate to the source is a scalar operator, which is basically just the Guarino operator. And this is there because it's a supersymmetric Yang-Mills theory, so it's got, you know, it always comes along with the supersymmetric premise. And strictly speaking, there will be, you know, fermionic pieces as well in the definition of the operator.
Is there some relation between the fact that this theorem of infinite size has a generalized conformal structure and on the gravity dual side, there's a framing which you can see that it's
ADS? Yes. Yes, that's going to come later. Yes, yeah, absolutely. Okay, so again, the non-trivial thing here is that this generalized conformal structure is respective of the quantum level. It's kind of easy to cook up the origins which have it passive level. The really non-trivial thing is when you start doing quantum loops that this actually gets respected. But here it gets respected, at least in perturbation theory, it's known it gets respected. And it's really due to the fact that it's got maximum supersymmetry, so everything cancels all the E. So again, this was the paper in 2008, it's about 100 pages or so, so it had eight appendices or whatever crazy things. It was in one of the appendices. Okay, so now in this theory, you can actually look at the two-point function. And if you want to do this in a limit, so we take this dimension, this coupling, and we make a top coupling, and taking a limit that's small, you can work in perturbation theory. You do a two-bit calculation for this operator. It's not as scary as it seems, actually. You get a two-point function of this operator, and indeed you get the structure that I wanted. So it's 1 over x to the 8, that's coming from the fact that the dimension of the operator, as I've defined, is just 4. And then the normalization factor comes off the top, and it depends on this dimension. You can do the same calculation in holography. It's not trivial, but you can go and do the calculation in holography, and you get a different power. Okay. And you see in both cases, these things, you know, these things here are really just powers of x. So in both cases, these things, you know, just appear as powers of the distance equal scaling gradient, but they're different in the two limits. So both limits, you can write it in this way. And you actually get just different powers of the scaling. Okay. So in this case, in my first description, I said, okay, one natural thing to do was to look at the infrared and the ultraviolet, and then you typically just collapse in one term. Here I've done a different expansion. I've done an expansion of Toff coupling, which again is then to take that Toff coupling effectively to zero, effectively, because that depended on position. You know, one was going to the infrared and one was going to the ultraviolet. So again, I've really gone to extreme infrared and extreme ultraviolet and seeing that this collapses to a power space. What Masanori Hanada is doing, actually in collaboration with Costas and various lattice groups around the world, is calculating the interpolating series in a number of cases. So they're doing, I think it's really two dimensions, two and three dimensions that they're doing, so that they can't be two. So that's, in a sense, your limit, your thing. So they're trying to get the subleading terms here, but the terms in the series, and from here you can actually do this. Well, it's harder to do because we don't understand the corrections in string theory, but they would ultimately want to match this to this. And then doing it for the stress transfer as well, for various reasons. So these maximum supersymmetric Yang-Mills theories, they're related to DP grains. The fact that you've got a dimensionally running coupling is related to the fact that, as Itzaki has answered that, when they first discussed this duality in 98, you often need alternative descriptions as you go in the really deep infrared and ultraviolet. But actually, this generalized conformal structure governs the dynamics over a wide range of energy scales. So typically, the very deep material will be the very near boundary. In the holography description, you need to change the description. So, for example, for D4 grains, you know that in the ultraviolet they become the N5 grains. But actually, this generalized conformal structure governs the dynamics of a very wide range of energy scales. I always have that slide there because people kind of complain that these things, you know, you have to do something else from the infrared and the ultraviolet. It's not relevant for the discussion here because this is happening over a wide range of scales. Second example, SYK. So I'm going to do it before I do the Gaussian average, just because it's kind of nice and trivial to see, but it's the same after you take the Gaussian average. This version, this was a classical version, manifestly has generalized conformal structure. And in fact, we already wrote this down on the first slide, because I said when you did the Legendre transformation, you get that the Hamiltonian is just the quartic operator. But actually, if you look at the form of my Borel identity and collapse it down into both dimensions, so this says that the trace of the stress energy tensor is up to, you know, the anomalies are not playing a role in here, so the trace of the stress stress tensor is proportional to the expectation value of my operators, which are driving my flow. And so here, what is happening is that I have exactly that kind of identity, right? So I have the Hamiltonian is just, so the Hamiltonian is the trace of the stress tensor, so that's what it comes in just one time dimension. So that H is driven by, effectively, the expectation value of these operators, which are just the four fermion operators. So the difference compared to my other case is that I actually have a very large number of interactions here, right? Because I have a large number of species of fermions. You can kind of, I guess, view this as one single operator, if you wish, or some number of operators. The diffeomorphism order identity is similarly, similarly right down, and it's the fact that the whole Hamiltonian is conserved by the couplings are time dependent. Okay, and in our case, look, the couplings are time dependent because we just chose them to be part of this Gaussian ensemble, and so they're trivially chosen to be time dependent. Now you average the couplings using a Gaussian distribution. Again, the resulting theory, so at the real quantum level, right? So I did do a sort of toy case where I was just looking at classical Lagrangian. But now I really look at what happens at the quantum level. And you can show that the theory really, again, has generalized conformal structure. And the flow here is actually being driven by these bilocal operators with equal sources for all of them. Okay, so again, this theory has a generalized conformal structure. So the Hamiltonian of the theory is proportional to the expectation value of these bilocal operators in the fourth power. So it has a generalized conformal structure. Okay, and in particular, let me sort of pause and say that, again, I'm not going into it here, but Robert Sanderman and Sanford and others have calculated that the correlation contribution is K, not just the leading contribution, but they calculated sub-leading contributions, and it exactly has the structure that I showed you, that there's actually, it's not just the power law, it actually has a whole series of terms which reorganize exactly to that generalized conformal structure. So SYK is another example of the generalized conformal structure. Now, this comes to Alberto's question, what is the holographic realization of generalized conformal structure? Okay. And so this goes back again, this is from the paper in 2008. So in theory with generalized conformal structure, we have a one identity involved the stress tensor and involved the scalar operator. If you want to realize that holographically, you need gravity to realize the stress tensor, and you need a scalar field to correspond to the scalar operator. So the minimal ingredient that you could actually expect is just gravity coupled to the scalar field. So let's just write down an action in p plus one dimensions. Let's just write down some rather arbitrary, it's not quite arbitrary actually, but let's write down something, we've got the Einstein term, the kinetic term, and then we've got a potential term. And so the thing that's really, I guess, the only non-trivial thing I've done here is really chosen the potential to be a particular form. And now anticipating the fact that it's very convenient to work not in Einstein frame, but in a different frame, I've actually not written this action in Einstein frame, but I've allowed an arbitrary coupling here. Now, it turns out that you can actually take your couplings, gamma, beta, and C, and you can choose them such that you get a solution which is anti-de-Sitter with running coupling. Okay, so if you tune your gamma, beta, and C, you actually get anti-de-Sitter solutions. And so indeed, gamma is called the frame in which the solution is ABS. So if you went to Einstein frame, this would not be anti-de-Sitter, it would be conformed to anti-de-Sitter. We choose the frame such that the metric is precisely anti-de-Sitter. Now, why do we want to do that? Well, the holographic dictionary says that the metric is dual to the stress tensor, the scalar is dual to the scalar operator. You can go through the holographic renormalization in this setup, and you can show that exactly with this setup, this action, that when the operator is dual to the metric and the operator is dual to the scalar field, precisely satisfy the required order identity. So we've essentially cooked up an action which automatically gives us the word identity that we want to get. Okay. And in the specific solution I wrote down on the previous slide, the source has been set to some specific value. in the shape of expectation value brackets and then the expectation value algorithm. So this was, in a sense, it comes from expertise in holographic engineering. We want to realize a particular word identity for the quantum field theory. We kind of cooked up an action which is automatically going to do that, and then we went through holographic renormalization. That's about 40 pages of paper, that's why I skipped it here, to actually show that this is what you get. Okay.
This relation between gamma, beta, and C, how restricted is that? What kind of freedom does that mean?
It leaves a sort of, one parameter family of solutions, which captures all the known cases that come from string theory realizations, and some which are not known to come from string theory realizations, they probably come from more complicated intersecting brain type systems. Yeah. So we get everything instead of doing specific cases, like the ones which come from the two brains, the one brain's fundamental strings, we did this more general analysis, and then later we realized that gamma, beta, and C, we essentially have one sort of one family of solutions which are left, and then we can match this with the known cases of the two brains and things like that. And then we found some other cases that other sort of things in the literature, and there are some where we still don't have string invariants, but they probably exist. Okay, so that's an open question. Okay, so we realized the board identity, so this will indeed describe our sort of theory of generalized signal structure. Now, another sort of interesting thing that we realized is that all of these theories can be viewed as a formal dimensional reduction from Antipas-Sitter theory over a torus of a specific dimension, which is related to alpha and gamma. So alpha was the running of the scalar, and gamma was the parameter which described the original frame. So you reduce over a torus of dimension minus 2 alpha gamma. Now, in special cases, minus 2 alpha gamma is a positive integer, but the formal structure persists even for the non-integer values. Why is that useful? Well, if you want to do hydrodynamics, you just do your hydrodynamics formally in two signal across all dimensions. You don't care that it's not integer. You can just do your hydrodynamics. And then you can read off your hydrodynamics and your physical theory just by doing this generalized dimensional reduction. And that was what we did in a later paper. Okay, so this is a kind of crazy fact, that all these theories seem to have inherent ADS theory. Now, a particularly special case of this discussion, where you'll be ready to hear we're not using a non-integer dimension for us, is in the case where you just reduce Antipas-Sitter in D plus two dimensions over the circle. And if you wish to, you can make the reduction, you can make it a Schwartz type reduction by you just include the gauge field here, as you go down from d plus two dimensions to d plus one dimensions. And so this was done in a paper with Reyes Pitero and Costas and the smaller sisters. In this case, something special happens. So the something special that happens is that the kinetic term for the scalar field drops out in the spring. So that term is just zero. So we've got this term, which is the gauge field term, but the kinetic time for the scalar just drops out. And so you can actually, without loss of generality, just rescale the scalar so that the gamma is just one. Okay. Now, for those who were following the story of holographic realizations of SOK, that will start to look familiar, but I'll come back to in a moment to tell you why it's familiar. Now, let's do this in the specific case of, so this was again in general dimensions, just to be clear, general dimensions, but let's start with ADS3 and reduce it over a circle. Okay, so ADS3 reduced over a circle. So ADS3 RT is dual to a two-dimensional conformal field theory. As we've said many times, this satisfies the relation in terms of the trace of the stress tensor, this is the anomaly, and it's the stress tensor is conserved. Now we're going to just reduce ADS3 gravity over the circle, and we're going to reduce the circle. So you decompose the stress tensor in Fourier modes. It's kind of a weird thing to do, because usually when you work in two-dimensional conformal field theory, you work with left and right moving modes. You don't reduce over the spatial circle. So it's a weird thing to do, but if you wish to, you can do it. You decompose the stress transfer in 4 modes, and you keep on with 0 modes. And let's relabel them. That's called the TT component with 0 mode Hamiltonian, the YY component, that's the scalar operator, and the TY component, we'll call it a current, right? Because that's effectively what it is. So when we do that, and we look at the stress, you know, how the higher dimensional, the standard Borean entities decompose in 4 modes, we again get exactly the same calculation that we discuss in the context of generalizing the construction. So the Hamiltonian is just driven by the expectation value of the scale operator. And the Hamiltonian is here conserved simply because the reduction is such that the source of this operator is effective. And then there is a formula on the term, which is okay, so the conclusion from here is if you take a two-dimensional conformal field theory and you reduce it over a circle, you get something which is got, and you just retain zero modes, you get something which has got generalized conformal structure. Okay? And it seems a very similar board identity to SYK. The thing that's different in SYK is that we have, instead of one operator driving the flow, we have one operator. But otherwise, it's basically the same. Now, this part was already noticed, as I said earlier, by Cetic and Dimitriou in summer 2016. So if you play the game, so you play this game and you start with BTZ black holes in 3 dimensions and you reduce on a circle, you reduce them on a circle, you get a 2-dimensional black hole with gauge field and a scalar field. And you can just use the standard holographic picture in 3 dimensions, just reduce it again on a circle, to pick up the expectation values of the operators, and you can actually just translate these, so these are the parameters of the horizon, you can just translate them in terms of the central charge and the temperature, and then you can see that actually you pick up the thermodynamics of SYK simply because of the underlying symmetry. So the fact that one has quantities which scale with the temperature is automatic if you start with a 3-dimensional ADS description and you reduce on the circle. You know, it really just came from the underlying symmetry of the system. You know, it was really that temperature dependence really comes from the underlying symmetry of the system. So the analog here is at the beginning days of ADS CFT, and people got for the D3 grain theory entropy which scaled as T cubed, and they threw their hands in the air and said, this is wonderful. And then everyone pointed out that was completely controlled by conformal invariants. And so we're saying here, once you realize that you get generalized conformal invariants, the scaling with T is really completely controlled by that. So that in itself is kind of trivial. And then the fact that the coefficients go with N, again, that's about margin accounting, right? So the fact that things agree was really because the models have the same underlying symmetry structure. So, you know, the fact that these black holes match the thermodynamics of SYK, we cannot declare victory because this is simply controlled by the symmetry. This is simply saying, okay, I've got this conformal field theory in 4 dimensions, and this conformal field theory, they both have an entropy that scales as T cubed, so they're the same thing. No, they're not. They both have entropy that scales as T cubed because they're 4 dimensional conformal field theories.
If one wants to attribute that directly to the 3 dimensional geometry, is the condition what you would need to do to the
So you need a symmetry in this. You need a symmetry in the field theory, right? You need an extra cycle.
I guess you need the Kaluza time.
Exactly. I think I commented it out, but there's a whole long discussion about that in the paper. So indeed, the fact that SYK itself does not have an SO2 symmetry means that it cannot be related just to 3 dimensions, because if you take ADS theory and use it in a circle, you always have that symmetry. So you have to add something to SYK to have that symmetry, and then it can be that. But then you're effectively back at saying, well, it's two-dimensional. Okay, so everything that worked much of the stuff that worked in SYK, matching between SYK and two-dimensional Lillikant gravity, simply did so because of the underlying symmetry structure. So we cannot declare victory and say that's a good description of SYK. We simply realize that, you know, if you describe the same symmetry structure, the same generalized conformal structure in 2 different ways, thermodynamic quantities which are controlled by it should actually behave the same. Okay. Now, for something I'll need a little bit later, I would like to notice the following. So in this case, these operators clearly acquired expectation values in the thermal state. And that was a rule in the chaos calculation, is that the operators that used pro-chaos should not have thermal one-way functions. They should have zero thermal one-way functions. They should have non-zero correlation functions. These operators actually also have trivial correlation functions. And so these are not the operators that you can use to probe chaos. So actually, to look at chaos in theory, you really have to add additional fields beyond the graviton and dilaton sector. I'll come back to that later. Okay, now let's come to the dual, perhaps not the dual of SYK, but the dual of the theory structure of SYK. So the dilaton gravity one gets the correct thermodynamics. Water density is very similar, but slightly different. It's slightly different because in the case of SYK, you have multiple operators. So an obvious question you can ask is, can you play the same trick that you played in 2008 to cook up a gravity action which has these dual to multiple scale operators? And so that was what I find in the sum. And indeed, you can easily cook this up. It's kind of obvious how you do it. So you just add, you know, set one scalar field, you have one scalar field. It's kind of obvious. You cook up your constant so that you get something which, again, has an ABS solution with running scalars. And this will indeed minimize exactly the identity that you needed to have. So I can always cook it up so that I have the tracing stress tensor is now driven by multiple scalar operators. Okay, so that's, you know, it's you know, a little bit of a tedious calculation, but you can do this. Now, in particular, for SYK itself, to match the dilatation water identity, you should have a scalar for every operator which is by the flow. So for every species of fermions, one should actually have a scalar of operators. But in the case of SYK, we also need to realize it so that the thermodynamic scales with the temperature, and that fixes what the form of beta has to be. And it turns out that the kinetic terms, betas, actually vanish. And so the solutions are just ABS2, so we now go on without ABS2, and these are the running scalars. And again, the kinetic terms for the scalars actually vanish. That requirement came from the fact that we really wanted to realize and generalize conformal structure such that the thermodynamic quantities scale with the temperature. And so, in particular, the thermodynamics determines that the sum of the alpha is just 1 and the kinetic terms vanishes. And so, this theory can always be viewed as a formal reduction of an ABS3. This theory here is always a formal reduction of an ABS3. And every scalar is associated with a reduction of a torus on a fractional dimensional torus. Fractional dimensional, so. Okay, so if this sounds kind of crazy, you should at this point think of doing non-critical string theory, I think. So you should be thinking about a world sheet theory in which each of these scalars is associated with something non-trivial that we've added in the world sheet theory. So it's kind of crazy from a gravity perspective, and that's how you break your SO2 symmetry. But you've got this fractional dimensional reduction. But you probably shouldn't think about it as really a gravity theory. One should really think about this as a non-critical string theory. And so if we do this, again, we realize exactly the relative water identity that we need to match SYK. But the price for what we've done here is, as I say, that this thing here, we've got a very large, we had a large number of these operators because we had a large number of species of fermions. And so we've got a scalar for every one of them. So we don't just have rarity, we've added a large number of different scalars, which is already very unconventional. And now we've said that formally, at least, there is a description in which each of these scalars is associated with a reduction on a fractional dimensional torus. Okay. So there's a formal structure that exists. And the water density matches SYK, and then automatically thermodynamics actually works. Thermodynamics works. Now, in fact, for the purposes of thermodynamics, you could replace these multiple scalars by a single scalar, which is effectively what Bonson and Stanford and Yang did in the gravity version of the SYK paper. So there were two papers on SYK from Bonson and Stanford. There was one from the field theory side, and there was one from the gravity side that they upgraded from Bonson's student Yang. And so they effectively used an action which was just a single scalar. So why did what they do, why did it in a sense work? Well, for the purpose of describing thermodynamics, the presence of these multiple scalars could simply be, you know, the effect of this background could be simply replaced by one scalar. But at the same time, if you start putting into the bulk, not just gravity and then the SVK operators, not just gravity and then the operators surrounding the flow, but all the other spectrum of the SVK theory, they don't couple identically to each of these terms. Right, so they'll couple differently to each of these terms. So in the SYK theory, you have operators which are just say the two-point functions of the theory, bifermion operators. They will couple differently depending on the species of the fermion that appears here. Okay? And so it's not true for the whole theory that you can actually couple identically to all of the phi A. You really, at some point when you want to realize the whole spectrum of SYK, you're forced to include this whole crazy set of different scalar fields in the universe this way. But for thermodynamics, this is the explanation of why what they did actually worked. Okay, now, so to understand this, let's think of the following. So I said that for the purpose of probing chaos, or for discussing other operators in the SRK spectrum, I'm going to have to introduce yet more fields involved. Okay, so let me just do this for one probe scalar field of a particular mass. And this would be drawn to now some generic scalar operator in SVK, which doesn't get the number. Now you can say that a priori, the couplings between these probe scalars and the running scalars I have here are not fixed. They will actually be determined actually by the operator OPs. So I can bootstrap, in fact this information is known. I mean, Gross and Rosenhaus and others have looked in detail at the operator OPEs, so I could actually use that information and work out the couplings. But it actually turns out that there's a kind of cheaper way of doing this, which agrees with what you would get from Gross and Rosenhaus. So this is just the term you'd expect for just the kinetic term and the mass term. In the coupling to gravity is just the standard coupling. So the real question is, how do these things, how do our probe scalars couple to our running backgrounds? So for any choice of these delta A's that show how these things couple to each other, so the probe scalar couples to the running scalar, the two-point functions would have scaling behavior. But actually, if you want to respect generalized conformal structure, that forces the delta A uniquely, and that actually agrees precisely with what you would get if you bootstrapped by knowing the OPEs from SYK, which people have worked out, okay? And so in fact, this respects the generalized conformal structure, and now I'm putting this rather more generally, because actually, if you were doing this in holographic realizations of theories drawn at maximum symmetric young Mills, again, we know that the chiral primaries would respect the generalized conformal structure too, so we actually know that those are coming up. So let me summarize. I should have had a slide to sort of summarize this section. For the purpose of just describing the thermodynamics, we can actually get all the information that's to be had about SVK really just comes from ward identity. And that really was equivalent to what Montana and Sanford did. But actually, the fact that in SVK you have all of these, quartic powers of bilocal field, all these operators driving the flow, you can't forget because the different operators involving different fermion species coupled to the SYK other operators in a different way. Okay, so one really does have to include all these different fields. So it's a very crazy holographic realization. And now when you couple a probe scalar to this, you need to take into account that it couples with background too. And that coupling is determined by generalized conformal structure or equivalently by the OPEs of SYK. So we know what those couplings are. Okay, finally, for the last half an hour or so, I'm going to come to chaos in these theories. So now I'm sort of going to take a step back, not necessarily specifically in SYK, I'm in a more general context. So I'm in a context of a holographic realization of generalized conformal structure. I could be in any dimension. So the key point here is that when we're talking about chaos, in the conformal case, we really only have two scales in the problem. So we were discussing a correlation function in which operators were separated in time by a particular value. So they were separated on the thermal circle by a particular value, but they were also separated in time. And then we had a temperature. And so the fact that we had a behavior of a correlation function which only depended on time and temperature, that trivially came from continuum invariance, right? You know, the fact that it behaves with an exponential factor with the Lyapunov exponent of, you know, 2 pi beta, that was non-trivial. But the fact that things only depended on the ratio of time and temperature, that really came from conformal structure. In the case of a theory with generalized conformal structure instead of conformal symmetry, we've got another scale in theory. Now, just to sort of simplify it now, I wanted the dimensional scale, so it's appropriate powers of this coupling that I've been writing down, but it's a scale which is related to this dimension V1 in coupling, which we can just translate in terms of that coupling. And there's a third scale in the theory. And so when we compute this out of time correlation function, what we need to do in general is to take operators V and W, which are generic operators that don't have thermal expectation value. We separate them around the thermal circle, and then we separate them appropriately. And in SYK, I actually chose my operators to be, the case that people analyzed, they actually weren't in the scalar operators, they were fermions. We just chose them to be the elementary fermions of the theory. That was the choice that we made. But in general, all they have to be is, well, generic operators in the theory that don't have thermal expectation values. Okay? And so when we do this, again, sort of generalizing what we did for SRK, our four-point function, there will be a trivial disconnect contribution, which is just the product of the two-point functions. And so here, again, the y is moving operator around the thermal circle, but the disconnect contribution, again, is just trivially the product of the two-point functions. And so what Monsanto-Schenker and Stanford are defining, they don't actually really say this explicitly enough, but what they're really defining is the ratio between the four-point function and the disconnected contributions. They define f of t, little f of t is that ratio, and it sends something which is manifestly dimensionless in a conformal field theory. Okay? And in conformal field theory, actually, whilst I've expressed it as a function of little t, it can only depend on the ratio of t to beta, the inverse term. And so the non-trivial thing that they argued was that this function, the leading contribution is of 1. That's just coming from the fact that the leading contribution to the four-point function is the disconnected term. The second contribution comes from the connected contribution to the correlation function. Okay? So this is the non-trivial contribution. And they're saying this is the interesting term. There may be other terms, and there are other terms. But this is the interesting contribution. Okay, and so actually, where does this come from? So where does this fact come from? Actually, it really comes from the relationship between the normalization of disconnected correlators and connected correlators in water vapor. So if you consider ADS equals 1 gravity. There's an overall normalization factor. There's, you know, a prefactor which depends on fours and pies and so on, depending on your dimensions. But the interesting prefactor of the supergravity action is just the power of n. And the power that occurs depends on the case that you're considering. So the case that's probably most familiar to you is n squared for the D3 grain case, ADS 5, D3, n equals 2.9 mils. But ADS 3, it goes as n. And ADS 4 famously goes as 3/2, and ADS 7 famously goes as 3. Okay, so this is the famous powers that people have been trying to get, and they get the localization for the M2-brain story and the M5-brain story. Okay. So it's not the case, I mean, so the power depends on the case that you're considering. And again, this is something that comes out of the string theory, N theory analysis from the solutions. It's a very non-trivial fact, which is about which tells us about the number of degrees of freedom that the theory is from. Now, go back to this expression. When we calculate correlation functions in holography, the disconnected correlation function, sorry, let me stop. The connected correlation function scales as one over the Newton constant. So it scales as a prefactor in there. Okay? This is true. So the supergravity normalization of correlators is that all of the connected correlators scale with the one over the Newton constant. Okay? This connected correlator sets a product of two-point functions. So that scales as one over the Newton constant squared. And so, of course, the ratio connected to disconnected is just that one over n to the factor. Okay, that's where that kind of came from. Monsanto and Sandler Schenker have that factor wrong because they have it always as two in all dimensions. That's not correct. Monsanto is happy to concede that, but not happy to put no citing for it. It's on camera, please cite me. But you know, this is not controversial. It doesn't really play a role because when they're discussing timescales, they always take the log of this term, and so the A disappears as a kind of trivial numerical factor in the log, so it doesn't play a role. But it is actually one thing that's not correct in the paper. Okay, so we've explained that factor. That's really the ratio of connected to disconnected correlation functions. And again, your intuition might tell you that that goes as 1 over n and 1 over n squared, but in biology, it really depends on the theory you're discussing, the power that comes up. Prefactor C is just a constant term, you know, that's not important either. So the important term comes from this exponential part. And so the claim here is really that the connected correlator, I think I'll give the argument in a bit more detail in a few slides' time, but the contribution to the connected correlator is dominated by exchanges which pass through near the net of the black hole horizon, where there's a rim of the boost factor which behaves as the exponential of the time separation, so the amount of time that the boosted particle spends in the horizon, boosted by the inverse temperature of the black hole. At least that factor really just comes from the boost factor. Okay, so yeah, I think I have this here. So again, what they're saying is, what this is saying is the following. So the disconnected correlation function, this disconnected contribution to the correlation function would be when you do a trivial Witten diagram, which would just be two lines, the product of two-point functions. Okay, the connected contribution, the non-trivial contribution here, is the contribution where there is an exchange. So this is a Witten diagram for a four-point function where we have, an interaction involved here, we have an exchange, and then we have, we have another interaction, and then that goes up into the operator. So this is a diagram for a four-point function. And the claim is that the four-point function is dominated by diagrams in which that exchange is actually passing the particle spends a long time in the black horizon. So we're in finite temperature background, it's spending a long time in the black horizon. So there's a shockwave argument for this, which I'll review below, and there's, I think, a more satisfactory argument, which is in one of the Schenker and Sandler papers, which talks about doing this through analytic continuation of Euclidean correlators, and that's what Monsanto and Sandler do in the SYK paper as well, where it sort of helps you understand why this is the dominant contribution. If away with temperature, that's going to fix from the Euclidean to the unknown tendency. So I fix those things. And then I go to the non-trivial thing that's going to come out of my holographic realizations, which tells me, which is about the dynamics of the theory without, a non-trivial thing of the dynamics of the theory without conformal structure, is these powers of A and B coming. Yeah, so that's what holography really does. Now, we said that we needed to add on top of this, we want to probe chaos, right? So we can't use the operators over here, we've got to use the operators which are not requiring thermal expectation values. So we've just got massive scalar fields, and then we said that we know how they couple to the background, and we know how they couple to the background because we want to preserve generalized conformal structure. The prefactor here now reflects the supergravity origin of the terms, and it's natural to absorb the L dependence into the scalar field definition itself, into the operator definition. If you wish to, you don't have to do that, it doesn't really play a role in what follows. The dots are telling us about interactions between these fields. So we know that we've got masses, we know how they interact with the background metric and the coupling and the scalar driving flow. That's controlled by generalized conformal structure. And then if we look at the OPU, B and W with each other, that will tell us about interaction. So we can kind of bootstrap the action from wish to. But for what we're saying, this doesn't actually play a role.
This is a different gamma principle from the other.
No, it's the same gamma. So in this particular case, to prove the generalized conformal structure, I must have a being exactly the same gamma. Yeah. Now, in non-conformal theory, such as we've got here with generalized conformal structure, the four-point function, we've now got three scales in theory. So not just t and beta, but we've got the scale L. Or another way we can put it is the Newton constant is dimensionful and depends on L. So it's not a priori obvious that F would behave as it did in the conformal case. But actually, if you look at what happens, again, we can define our function F as the ratio of the full four-point function to the disconnected contribution. Again, we get exactly the same behavior. In the supergravity limit, the L permanence drops out. Although if you went beyond the supergravity limit, the L would actually come in there. Okay, so in the supergravity limit, it drops out. And this really follows entirely from the generalized conformal structure. But you can also see it from the shockwave argument. So here's the shockwave argument. Sorry, if I were better at drawing diagrams and takes, I think I would draw my own diagram here to illustrate what's going on. We're working in the background, which is a black hole. So the black hole energy scales with the inverse Newton constant. Okay, so the black hole energy is this. But the energy of the pulse that you send in at early times also scales with this factor, because that's the parameter which controls the energy here. So it also scales with this factor. And now what happens in the shockwave argument is that you send in, you know, effectively what you're saying is that the connected contribution to the four-point function is really controlled by a pulse which is just moving along the horizon. So it's just passing along the horizon. And what is controlling everything is the amount of time it spends close to the horizon. So in other words, the operator separation in your four-point function, that gives you your time scale. And so the amount of time that you spend in the horizon is controlled by that time scale. So your pulse gets boosted by a factor which is just a limit factor. So this is just the Sanford and Schenker and Roberts argument. So it gets boosted. And now, in their argument, this process, this connected contribution, becomes of order one to this connected contribution when the boosted energy of our pulse is comparable with that of the black hole energy. And so what we've got to do is take the black hole energy, take the pulse, boost it by this factor, and ask when they get to be comparable. But you see the factors of L, which control the energy, just drop out of this calculation. And so the boosted energy is comparable, but in this time scale. And that's the thing that we use here. So this is saying that this is essentially when these are comparable, this is when the connected contribution is comparable to the disconnected contribution. This is what controls this factor here. So that's one way of seeing the argument. Now there's another way of seeing the argument, which is perhaps more elegant, which is all these non-conformal actions, as I said, you can always uplift them to these formal antiposites in two sigma plus one dimensions. And so you can just do the ADS calculation in two sigma plus one dimensions, and now you're really interested in shock waves which are not doing anything non-trivial along this non-interdimensional porous. Maybe it's interesting to think about what happens if they do something non-trivial, but in our shock wave, if our shock wave is not going along this weird non-interdimensional torus, we're just doing exactly the same calculation as we would do for the ADS case. And this is another reason for understanding why the L factors just drop out of the game. Because really, everything that's controlling the calculation is just a boost of this uplifted ADS factor. And again, you can apply this argument further. Now, this is it's kind of a nice argument, but as I said to people the other day, I would still like to see a more direct argument that this connected contribution really localizes in this way. But this is a hard calculation to do, and that's why Ricardo has been contributing to do it. So it's a difficult calculation to do this directly. What you need to do is real-time holography to see the exponential growth in time. So actually, actually already setting up the contour, which is what we did with the photo in the summer, for the the outer time correlator is associated with a particular contour in the quantum field theory. To realize that holographically, you have to appropriately glue together Euclidean and Lorentzian sections and then check that this is actually reproducing the physics. So already that part, setting up the bulk geometry with a mixture of Euclidean and Lorentzian sections, is non-trivial. And now what you have to do is actually calculate an exchange diagram of this pipe and show that this exchange really does get localized in the black hole horizon. So that is what we're doing with the photo. And there are other things that you'd like to do as well. So I didn't say anything about this apparent numerical constant C. It's just meant to be vaguely of order one. But actually, it's interesting because the finite contributions and this numerical constant are really sensitive to the full power of states that you exchange. And as I said, even if you do this kind of calculation in Anti de Sitter process 5, you would actually really see an exchange of the full applying power of states. And it's far from obvious to me that that full exchange wouldn't contribute to the C and that they would all behave in the same way, and so on and so forth. There's intuition from George Santos and my colleague Oscar Diaz that they actually think the C is not a constant, but it actually has a power of time regressing. They get that from understanding the instability of ADS. They think there's a non-trivial behavior here. I mean, they suspect that this argument is just too fast. It's just it's done by thinking about the linearized back reaction of a pulse, and actually if you look at non-linear effects of that pulse, you get more correct. So anyway, it's an interesting thing to do. The first part of which is what we were doing with Ricardo, which is setting up the contour and actually really seeing how to do this with real time modeling. Okay, so if that's what we say here. So this is setting up, even just setting up the contour, you have to glue together Lorentzian black holes with Euclidean black holes in the and you've got to insert the operators at one set of early time, one at late time, show that the exchange gets dominated by the geodesic passing force of the black horizon. Okay, let me conclude. So what Montesano and Co. called the nearly conformal ADS is really an example of something that had a name beforehand, albeit not necessarily a better name, a generalized conformal structure. Okay, and there's a much sharper definition than actually they gave. So generalized conformal structures are weaker than conformal symmetry, but constrains the correlation function of the series. It constrains both the structure and it gives you more identities for the correlation functions. Whenever you realize generalized conformal structure holographically, at leading order in supergravity approximation, the chaos four-point function exhibits exactly the same behavior as in ADS, which was, as I said, non-trivial, because it was a priori non-trivial that the extra scalar theory set by the dimensional coupling wouldn't come in and play a role. But actually it dropped out of the calculation, and it drops out of the calculation most precisely because the generalized conformal structure, when you realize it holographically, always has these parent ADS theories. And it's one way of seeing it, for example. It's still a puzzle to me, actually, if you realize generalized conformal structure just in a perturbative sense, it would simply not be true that the chaos four-point function wouldn't depend on the dimensional coupling. It would. So it's really non-trivial in the holographic realizations that it actually drops on. Now, a lot of open issues here. The holographic dual to SYK and related theories has many low-mass fields. One interesting question here, so what came out of trying to sort of realize and sort of from a bootstrap is that you seem to need this large number of scalar fields, and it seems to be related to a non-interdimensional torus, a non-interdimensional reduction. It's kind of obvious to ask, could you phrase that instead in terms of a non-critical string theory, which has generalized conformal structure? Or more generally, can we write down a string theory, a non-critical string theory, which has generalized conformal structure? So I can clearly write down a critical string theory, which has got generalized conformal structure. I can do that kind of cheaply by putting strings in D4-brain backgrounds and so on and so forth. But it's sort of the minimal ingredients for a non-critical string theory. You see, SYK is one-dimensional. You can see that you get an extra dimension from doing RG flows, so that makes two dimensions. But there's no other symmetry of the theory, no other global symmetry. So there's no sign that you would need 10-dimensional string theory to realize it. Okay? There's no sign of that. So if you want to realize things with the string theory in two dimensions, it's going to have to be non-critical, right? You're going to have to make it up with other things. And so the suggestion is, can you cook up a non-critical string theory where the stuff that you add on the world sheet theory does your generalizing form structure for you? And so that's a question which we're exploring. Okay, so that's the first question. It could also, of course, be people talk about is it maybe a higher spin theory. For me, it's a bit of a pedantic distinction whether you call it a higher spin theory or a non-critical string theory, right? Because a higher spin theory is as soon as you break the symmetry, then effectively people really need to have a string theory description to get the massive noise from it. But okay, my first guess is to try and realize it as a non-critical string theory with this structure. The second question is, again, I would like to see a more explicit confrontation of chaos orbit functions with Witten diagrams and real-time holography. And the third observation is that, again, it's non-trivial that the dimensional coupling drops out of the chaos orbit function. It does not drop out in perturbative realizations. It does not drop out. If you just look at, you can't, of course, explicitly contribute and calculate them. But you can see that they're going to drop. You can see that when you take into account subleading contributions, from corrections to the actual non-supergravity, that the L dependence will explicitly come in. So it's saying that when we realize generalized conformal structure holographically, it's another case of actually super special because the dimensional coupling actually drops out in this calculation. And I think that's a kind of a profound observation. So, just like we often ask in holography, when can we actually realize conformal field theory in gravity? And we've got various constraints. So in four-dimensional conformal field theories, we know that the two anomalies, A and C, have to match in a larger limit to actually realize the Einstein gravity. We said at the beginning, you also expect, if your theory is going to be realized with just Einstein gravity, you should have a gap in the spectrum. You should have some low-dimensional operators, and you should have a big gap. Okay, now we're saying if you're going to be able to realize a theory with generalized conformal structure in just Einstein gravity, this is actually a limit. This is a restriction, right? You should only be able to do this if the dimensional coupling drops out of the chaos orbit function. So again, if I cook up kind of rather general theories with, rather random theories with generalized conformal structure, it must be such that when I try, take the strong tough coupling limit, it should actually be the case that the dimensional coupling drops out of the chaos. Okay, I think I will stop there. See, I'm gaining time each time, so it's actually. And you guys asked less questions in Oxford, because in Oxford, I think I got to, it took 2 hours and 15 minutes to get through the slides, right? So, the same slides. So.
Questions?
This effective action that you have with these parameters, gamma and beta, come from sigma model?
So that's actually precisely the last question. It's really precisely that. Yeah, that's exactly how we're trying to answer the question. So you see, the way we've gotten it is to say, we want this word identity in quantum field theory for the stress tensor and the operator driving flow. And now we cook it up with a holographic dictionary or holographic denormalization. This is what the gravity action has to do. Now the question is, could this come from a beta function calculation for a string theory? And that's exactly how we're trying to cook up a non-critical string theory, which would actually give these actions. So in special cases, we know that this action, because we've got already the D-brain, D-brain construction, we kind of exactly know where it comes from. So really, it's just the standard beta function calculation, and so it's the standard string theory description, and the beta function just gives us supergravity equations in 10 dimensions, and then supergravity equations with reduced mass scale give us this. But your question still stands, that if I just take a random sort of low-dimensional thing, and I don't think there's a critical 10-dimensional string theory description, I think it's got a non-critical description, then I would kind of go back and say, what kind of supermodel could give me this? And that's exactly how we're trying to do it. Yeah. That is how we're trying to answer the first question. I should say actually that Costas has a lot of interest in his theories of generalized cohomological structure because these two-dimensional maximus metric and Mills theories he's trying to solve on the lattice because he wants to use them for holographic cosmology for attempts to use holographic descriptions in cosmology. So he has a lot of other motivations for exploring theories of cohomological structure. So, you know, in the ones that are putting on the lattice, it's explicitly known maximum symmetry from Mills, but he'd like to understand more generally the sort of the field theory space of the theories of generalized conformal structure, and now when can you get them holographically, you know, what strings are you to? So we have that
interest. Yes, the first thing is this computation of the Markov function. I guess you need to book the knowledge from later.
Yeah. Okay, so there's multiple elements in this calculation, right? So let me go back here. There are multiple elements in this calculation. So first of all, to see the fact that it's really dominated, you know, so if the claim is correct, then regardless of what light particle exchange, you should get this boost factor. Okay. And so indeed you do the boundary to bulk propagator and the bulk to bulk propagator. So I should have said actually that to make this tractable we're in three dimensions.
Okay.
Yes, so we're trying to do it in PTC. So actually to have analytic control. So that's the first element of the calculation. Okay, and that's interesting in itself. Secondly, really to assemble all contributions, you need to allow all particles to the exchange, right? So you've got to take into account the summation of all the particles. And rather there's rather little literature in the CFT literature on assembly all the contributions. And then the third issue, which it may be trivial, but I can't find completely convinced that it's trivial, is that the other contributions you have to the four-point function, so you have these three-point interactions in an exchange, but you also have a four-point interaction. So what does the four-point interaction do? And why is that subleading? Yeah, and actually that nobody has written that down. So there's multiple elements to the calculation. And even the first part, which is sort of said here about setting up the contour, was in itself not entirely trivial.
This point about the constant in front C being maybe time dependent,
yeah.
Does that, I mean, I understand you're trying to get the an accurate representation of this correlator, but does that change the conceptual issues? Or?
Yeah, it depends what the conceptual issue is, right? Because if C grows parametrically, or you know, behaves different parametrically with time, you could say it depends what question you're actually asking. Yeah, so if you're asking on the time scale of the onset of chaos, it's just been slightly corrected, right? So because when you take the log of that expression, it's just been slightly corrected. So you can say from that perspective, well, it's not qualitatively changing the answer. On the same time, making it choppy is, of course, a good thing. It's going to be a more significant change than taking the logarithm of this expression and realizing that A is not actually 2 in every case, but it's, you know, 3/4 and 1 and 5/4. Where indeed, you know, one can correctly say, well, that really doesn't change the physics, right? Because that 3-factor is not plentiful. So the qualitative features are likely, you know, with that modification, are likely to be unchanged, but it's a sharper estimate. And, you know, again, there's sort of various intuitions from the camp who do perturbations of ABS that actually they think that C could be time dependent. Now, of course, you know, George Santos' intuition is not necessarily sort of right, but, you know, he has, of course, done a lot of calculation and simulations in that context. Yeah.
Okay, and then another separate question. Did I understand correctly you're saying that if you have a field theory that we generalize from a structure, then it's not a given that the L factor will drop out?
In fact, it is a non-trivial feature of SYK. So SYK has generalized conformal structure. But that on its own does not guarantee that the J is going to drop out of, you know, it was a priori that J could have been there in the Kipionov exponent. And the fact that it wasn't, you know, that is non-trivial in itself and still doesn't have an explanation. Because I said here that actually in theories where you really need to take into account string interactions, this L is going to come into the chaos ordering function. So however we realize SYK holographically with some non-critical string, whatever it is, it's going to be completely non-trivial still that the dimension for parameter J does not come into the leading contribution of the four-point function. The leading in there. As ever, I'm always suppressing loops in N, right? So I'm always in a limit where I'm suppressing kind of string loop effects or so on. Yeah, so that's not explained by what I'm doing.
And then I guess another thing that confuses me is that to begin with, you're talking about having all these light modes.
Mm-hmm.
But then on top of that, you seem to be talking about string interactions, meaning that all of these light modes.
We have to separate this. So in the case where the supergravity is in itself a good approximation, so that's true for, say, that you know the non-conformal D brains and D2 brains, then it makes sense to talk about string corrections, right? In the context of SYK, you know, in the middle of the discussion, we said, you know, we realized why the dilaton gravity model captured many of its features. It's simply because they match the structure. But we still don't expect the real physics of SYK to be captured just by, you know, dilaton gravity. So in that case, you know, whilst that gets the thermodynamics right, we really think that the whole description is a non-critical string theory of some kind. And then indeed, you're not talking about corrections to, you know, corrections to it. The whole description is a non-critical string theory. Yeah.
So the whole set of scalars that you're talking about are already coming from.
So we would think that actually it really comes from a non-critical description.
Okay.
And then the puzzle is why does the you know parameter J, why does that not play a role in the chaos? And you know, if this is a non-critical theory, why is it that a simple black hole description seems to work? Because if we're working in terms of non-critical string theory, the very definition of black holes is a mess, right? So that's the part. So we can see why dilaton gravity matched SYK just because they had the same underlying symmetry structure. Yeah. But we don't really believe that SYK, even with these multiple scalar fields, we don't really believe that that's the best description, because again, the presence of all these low-lying operators means that, you know, if you bootstrap and your effective action involves a very large number of degrees of freedom, a very large number of fields, so we already have the gravity plus the scalars growing on the flow, and then we say in addition to that, we need to put in all the very light operators.
Right.
But then if you have, an action with n to the fourth different fields in it, you know, that's ill-defined in itself and not able to control them. So that's not really how we expect to bootstrap it. We really expect to have to do it with non-critical strings, or we expect it to complete in terms of some higher spin theory. So another way of phrasing it, it could be that they just reassemble themselves into a rather nice higher spin sort of construction. I don't see much evidence.
We know that in other comment that you see the distinction between higher spin and non-critical spin theory.
Trivial, yes. Because you have to break the higher spin symmetry in practice.
In this context, or do you mean always?
I think you would have to here because you don't, in the SYK theory. So if you really have high spin theory, in the field theory, that means that you have an infinite sequence of conserved currents. We don't have this in SYK. So if we have that symmetry, we've broken it. And so as soon as you've broken it, you've given masses to the highest spin theories in the bulk description, and then effectively I think it's, you know, whether you view that as a string theory or not is a bit up to you. Yeah.
Okay.
So people with Vassiliev theory would say, well, the Vassiliev theory is really a massless limit of a string theory, right? Of a non-critical string theory.
Is that understood, or is that expected?
At least qualitative expectation is that, right? Of course, the precise limit, but that's, you know, that was the discussion of, say, Kardemoff and Polyakov and Co. from 15 years ago.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So as soon as you go to breaking the highest spin symmetry, and say, whether you choose to call it a massive highest spin theory or I choose to call it a non-critical spin theory, it's a little bit pedantic. In practice, we're going to have to decide how we're going to package the information. And in reality, the examples that we think we understand the best, we probably package it as a string theory. Right, that's our best chance. We could go to signal model type descriptions.
More questions?
I haven't said anything about the fracture of Why this is not important?
I don't have, I could have had a dialogue about that. It just doesn't have, I don't think I have anything more to add on that. The transformation that they're doing, you can reinterpret that, that with generalized conformal structure and say that that's respectful conformal generalized conformal structure. But I just don't have anything more to add to that. So, you know, I left it out for reasons of brevity in a sense. Yeah, that I don't think I have anything substantially to add to that story.
More? No? Okay, so thanks again for today and for the whole.